Jay, did you see that? Their opening question. Tell them what's the open. Tell them what the opening question is.
How long do you have?
Oh man.
I wasn't black enough to be with the black girls and boys, and I wasn't Hispanic enough to be with the Latin students because we don't speak Spanish in Belize. So I found myself kind of not having any, being able to identify solely with any group of people. And so the people who actually befriended me were the Jewish kids, because they all, some of them had curly hair like me and came in different complexions, and they were fine with not having someone who fit into this box of what black is, what white is, and what Hispanic is.
This is the first part of a series of multiple discussions concerning the broad history of race, science, including biomedicine, genetics, as well as issues in anthropology and history about geography, culture, and violence. This is a public discussion which will, in many ways, focus on historical issues, including issues related to the Samuel George Morton cranial collection.
Just before this panel. And for me, it spoke a lot about what we are experiencing in this moment, in this country, and in this world. For years, we have been living on top of bones and ghosts, buried deep beneath the surface. And we have been walking on them, and we have been trampling on them, and we have not been paying attention to them. And yet, eventually, these things come to the surface. And so, for me, a lot of what we're seeing are the bones coming to the surface. The things we have buried long and deep into the earth that we had forgotten, that we wish wouldn't reappear.
The one specimen that I took from the African series is very important in many ways. So this one, of course, in the label you can see it says Negro born in Africa. There are about 60 crania in this series that all hail basically from a sugar plantation in Havana, Cuba. And they all seemingly died around or maybe directly in the year of 1832. And lots of us have come to the conclusion, were of course brought to the Americas on slave ships, but probably died in the cholera epidemic, which occurred in 1832, as it had hit the Americas and was devastating in the Americas at that time. So this would have been a person who basically just arrived and basically probably worked for, you know, some short period of time, maybe a year, a couple of years, on the sugar plantations in Cuba, and then died of cholera. But before I get to the interesting part, I should tell y'all that this individual died as a young person. And I know this because the third molar teeth are present and have not yet erupted through the bone. So one of the things that I found actually on this African sample had been difficult for me to describe actually. So if I sit the skull down actually on this pad, it doesn't even sit well, I think you can see, because usually it sits right on the occipital on the condyles that actually link the head to the vertebral column. That vertebra is called atlas because it holds up the head, right? So that vertebra is fused actually to the base of the skull, and in a very dramatic and very asymmetrical way. But when I was looking at the rest of the collection, all of them have some kind of an issue basically with that first cervical vertebra, and I had no idea for a very long time what was going on. And then what happened was I was researching sugar plantation and slave people actually for a talk in the public program for the public classroom. And of course I was looking at a lot of images actually, just sort of pacing through them. Of course there were many images that were taken at the time, paintings, woodcuts, all sorts of things. And I came upon a series of woodcuts that actually showed that the plantation workers were actually marched back and forth from where they were working probably to where they were living, and from the beaches where they landed inland, by being linked together by a clamp, a board that went around the base of their skull, really at their neck, and link them in a chain all with each other. So they were walking. Can you imagine how jarring that would be? They were walking with their heads basically stuck together. And so, you know, everybody has a different cadence and everybody has a different movement up and down of their center of gravity. So they would have been constantly, okay, knocking, okay, essentially the base of their skull against the frame of this board. And I suspect that's why we see so many of these issues at the base of the skull. And for me, basically, it's like where enslavement becomes part of biology. I guess that's when I really, I mean, then I thought, you know, that is truly wicked.
Oh, this is what I want to say. Okay. So to me, when I see this collection of crania, it doesn't represent science. It represents colonial violence. That's what I really wanted to say.
That's perfect.
Okay. I'm Stephanie Mack, and I'm a graduate student in anthropology. This collection is particularly interesting because it is world famous. It's one of the largest collections of crania that was amassed in the 19th century to discuss like racial science. It's housed here at the Penn Museum, and we use it in teaching and research. We also put them on display. They're currently on display in the galleries right now, some of the materials. What you won't find on display are any Native American remains. Native American remains are considered sensitive materials. They are a special category of NAGPRA, which is the Native American Graves Protection and Repatriation Act, which stipulates, among other things, like sacred objects and culturally sensitive materials, that these items can be repatriated to federally recognized tribes. Human remains are definitely a category that falls under NAGPRA. So for that reason, you will not see them on display in the galleries, and you won't see them in use during the public classroom sessions. It is interesting to me, though, that it requires a law to recognize that these are not objects, but that these are human beings that whose descendants still relate to them spiritually, religiously, or in other ways.
Dehumanization of a people is systemic and it leads to so many other problems. If people aren't viewed as real people, it's a lot easier to treat them really badly.
Wherever truth is loved or science honored, his name will be revered. He does not die whose fame endured. Really handle them if you would like, actually, but also to just look at them, get the gestalt of them. That might be the best way to think of it. We actually divided them on 5 tables based on the races that Morton used, and you can use your own eyes basically to see probably one of the most key features or facets of a collection like the Morton collection, that there's a huge amount of variation within each one of these categories. And there wasn't an emphasis in Morton's time on the variation. There was an emphasis on really classifying those beings in these nice little pots, these nice little categories.
I don't think there's any single definition of race. And the idea of race and how you divide groups of humans has evolved over the last, 150 years in the United States.
Do you believe that black people are inferior in intelligence because of their heredity?
My research leads me, and it's a tragic conclusion really, my research leads me inescapably to the opinion that the major cause of the American Negro's intellectual and social deficits is hereditary and racially genetic in origin, and thus not remediable to a major degree by practical improvements in environment.
Neuroscience and genetics is progressing at an incredible rate. To talk about the environment as being the explanatory variable for all these differences now is just to stick our heads in the sand.
Points you can make about these racial categories is that they aren't the same through time or space. Mm-hmm. So depending on where you go, there might be an intermediate category between white and black that is operative and real and tangible. And so I think one of the really important themes to drive home is that we reconfigure our notion of what race is depending on where we are and when we are.
Are we being intellectually honest? Because on one hand we say, the word race equals racism. And so if we're looking at race because of the color of my skin, I don't see anything negative about the color of my skin. So for me to be identified as a black American is not racist.
Must ensure that new genome science and its benefits will be directed toward making life better for all citizens of the world, never just a privileged few. And we must guarantee that genetic information cannot be used to stigmatize or discriminate against any individual or group. All of us are created equal, entitled to equal treatment under the law. After all, I believe one of the great truths to emerge from this triumphant expedition inside the human genome is that in genetic terms, all human beings, regardless of race, are more than 99.9% the same.
I've got a bomb to drop. Biologically speaking, race doesn't exist.
Oh my goodness, we've all been lied to! Wait, why am I hosting this show?
So it's not just, you know, sort of juggling around and trying to find the right word. It's really trying to sort of recast and reformulate the way we understand human diversity. The word doesn't matter so much, but how, and because we don't actually give it a life in the same way that we give racism a life, it's more insidious. Do you know what I mean? It's always there, and it's always, you know, sort of showing its ugly face.
I think it is really worth reflecting on the question of why it would be that an American, within a particular context, within the context of slavery, within the context of the oppression of Native Americans, why would those, what does Morton's project and his results have to do in that context? How is that different than Friedrich Tiedemann's in Germany? It's an interesting question, and of course, this also changes in Germany and the United States through time.
Human diversity is quite recent in the history of the evolution of the genus Homo. The diversity of Homo sapiens is not very ancient. It has perhaps 200,000 years. And this is also an argument to think about this diversity and its meaning.
Is it to really truly understand human diversity, you have to understand that in the context of the history, not just of populations, but of people, of social contexts, of cultural contexts. There are no people without history. There are no questions without history. And understanding that is, I think, an essential component to appropriately interpreting and critically analyzing the science.
We talked about the fact that Morton, no matter how you cast him, was a racist. He probably was a polygenist. He was interested in ranking races based on skull size. He also, too, did a ranking based on the degree of projection of the face. He made comments that the, you know, sort of more projecting the face, the more ape-like the faces actually became. So not just on the score of cranial size, but also on face size, he was, you know, crafting essentially this hierarchy of races.
It's really arbitrary where people have been placed, and also there are many different groups from 5 to 22 for Morton and Brinton and other people who ultimately were asked to define what these categories are on population censuses.
Mm-hmm. Pretty much with every census, the categories change. And it's not as if the people have changed and somehow we, you know, reassigned, I don't know, somehow, you know, computers sort of resorted all of us, and like color went from, you know, yellow to darker yellow, whatever. It's not that. It's a categorization of people. And the groups that we think of as groups today are not the groups that even at the beginning of my training were the groups, and probably in the next decade or two is also gonna change.
These categories emerge in particular historical contexts, mm-hmm. Based on particular political realities, yeah. You know. What is seen as a need of the United States at any given moment, what is seen as a need to keep out, you know? And even the opening in 1965, as you say, I think that really raises then the profile of the national origins question, mm-hmm. not only for so-called Hispanic groups, but also Black groups, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Because that's what opens up non-European mm-hmm. migration mm-hmm. from the quote-unquote third world. And mm-hmm. so Caribbean migration, African migration, you know, because of the putting together in neighborhoods and schools based on our particular U.S. history of race, it generates tensions, but it also can generate solidarities. Absolutely. Right? And so I think there's been a lot of tense discussion about migration mm-hmm. in this election mm-hmm. period.
No wall! No wall! No wall! No wall! No wall! No wall! No wall!
And so for me, a lot of what we're seeing are the bones coming to the surface. The things we have buried long and deep into the earth that we had forgotten that we wish wouldn't reappear are now reappearing. And I think that we should think about that. And we should really take a long look at this moment, because clearly burying our sentiments does not make them go away. Eventually they do fester and bubble over. And for me, that's something that this is a moment that requires pause and reflection. This is not just our moment in the United States either.
There's a lot of media reinforcement to the idea that there are these essential categories of people, that there are black people and white people and East Asian people, and that this defines a lot of your essential risk for disease, your propensity to get certain diseases, even certain behaviors, certain traits. There's a lot of reinforcement to this kind of racial determinism. And I would hope that the audience would get from this panel discussion some skepticism about how determining those factors really are. And even to the extent that they are associated with some traits, diseases, risks, how much of that is really essential? How much of that is necessary biologically versus a function of our social definitions and our social treatment is something that I would hope people would think about.
But a point I want to emphasize is that it's not as if there's something natural in the brain that causes them to be discriminatory against patients. It's part of a system of medical education that directs them to do that. That means we can change it.
So we have, you know, I think some of the worst racial health inequities in the developed world, and I use that word inequities intentionally. A health disparity is something that comes from biology. An average woman would have a higher chance of having breast cancer than me because she has more breast tissue. That's a disparity. Infant born in the city of Philadelphia that is black will have multiple times higher chance of dying within the first year of life than an infant born that's white. That's preventable, and it's because of our social system. That's an inequity.
It was such a stark illustration of how health ties into everything. And health is affected by everything around us too. How can we take an honest look at who we are as a society and call out these issues that may be difficult, but if it's not us calling out that racism is a public health issue, that violence is a public health issue, that poverty is a public health issue, then who else is going to be doing it?
What I'm saying when I say that people are trying to absolve themselves is genetics is a powerful tool to explain differences in biology. But what I often see is that people find a gene that explains maybe some of the difference or might be a causative factor, and they say this is the end of the story. this is what's causing these differences. And that is, you know, I think more often not true.
So it becomes this kind of what we call politics of pity, where you say, okay, we'll give you this, but it's not actually affecting that. So
wait,
this
I
is,
need exa- what do you mean?
So yeah, I'll use the example of the Healthy People 2010, you know, sort of mission statement to eliminate racial and ethnic health disparities. And one thing that the researchers were not allowed to kind of study is insurance. You were not allowed to factor insurance into your research. So you had to just study racism in the clinic. Well, what we've seen since the Affordable Care Act is the life expectancy of African American men going up rather quickly.
Wow.
So that was a structural issue more than a racism in the clinic issue.
What you find is these easy explanations of differences. Okay, well, this person is more sick because they're black. And if they're black, they may have this gene. Or if they're black, we at least know that they're more susceptible to that. And it's probably because of biology. We don't think that maybe this person might be more sick because they're living in, you know, an area of West Philadelphia that was historically redlined 50 years ago. And because they were redlined, you know, they live in an area that has very few parks, that has low quality housing, that produces asthma, that has violent schools and violent streets and instances of police brutality, and that raises their blood pressure. That's the end of the story. If the problem is who they are, then it doesn't matter. We're free, it's not our fault. You were born black and that made you sick. Not you were born into a place that hates black people or treats black people in a certain way, and that stress on your body, on your mother's body, on your father's body made you sick. And so I think that when you're dealing with populations that are under that sort of stress, not acknowledging that is almost, you know, tantamount to malpractice.
One thing I would want the audience to know is that, and I'm sure all of my colleagues agree, we need you just as much as we think you need us. Meaning we need you to pose challenging questions to us that force us and challenge us to do a better job of explaining what it is that we know.
Your path, hallowing your evil ways, like they were yourself, passing yourself, not smiling.